Are you afraid to die? This primal fear, a driving force in the biological world, is not just a human concern, but a fundamental aspect of biological life. From the smallest cells to the most complex organisms, the instinct to survive shapes our behaviors and our evolution. Now imagine a world where artificial intelligence doesn't just perform the tasks we tell it to, but learns from our primal drive to survive. What happens when machines start understanding the concept of survival, not as a fear of cessation, but as an impetus for evolution and adaptation? This leap reflects a significant evolution in how we understand and develop technology, and it's a gigantic step on the road to AGI. We're not just programming machines anymore. We're teaching them to learn from the very essence of life itself. But this journey goes beyond mere survival. It's about understanding the intricate dance of existence, a symphony of interactions, adaptations, and transformations. And through this understanding, AI is poised not just to mimic life, but to evolve in its unique and unprecedented way. This evolution is brought to you by Mortal Computation, a concept that transcends traditional static AI systems, yielding to systems that evolve, adapt, and even die. By the end of this video, you'll understand this simple yet profound idea and how it will reshape your life, your work, and most importantly, your perception of yourself.
Like tears. Rain.
In order to make sense of any of this, we first need to look at nature's computational systems. After all, these are the systems that AI is mimicking when we talk about biomimetic intelligence. And we can't talk about that without talking about the fungus among us. Most of us don't see them, but they are everywhere, even inside of ourselves.
Fungi don't have seeds, they have spores. The mushroom releases zillions of spores into the atmosphere. There's so many spore, I mean, you take one breath, you just breathed in 10 fungal spore. So they are everywhere. We've evolved with them.
Most people associate fungi with death because we don't really notice them until we see the dead and the dying. That's when we see the fungi performing its most critical role in recycling the nutrients of life. Life could not exist without the fungi. They transform death, fighting against thermodynamics and entropy by creating complexity and order out of the chaos of decay. And they've been here doing this since the beginning. 4.5 billion years ago, it was the fungi that were Earth's first architects, constructing networks that transformed barren land into fertile soil capable of supporting life.
Mushrooms represent rebirth, rejuvenation, regeneration.
But this role of rebirth is just the beginning of the story. The fungi do much, much more than just eat dead things. The mushroom itself is the fruiting body of the fungi, like the apple of an apple tree. The bulk of the organism exists under the ground, composed of these long threads growing one cell at a time, branching, merging, expanding. This is the mycelium. This vast network grows through the entire forest, connecting everything in it. There is a vast universe that exists just beneath our feet, responding to every step we take.
Mycelium that can grow out even just this big can have trillions, literally trillions, of end branchings.
The trees took notice of this fact long, long ago.
Trees are communicating using the mycelium as pathways. They're connecting one tree to another. They're using the mycelium too to feed one another. In other words, one tree can swap nutrients with another tree using mycelium as the passageway.
It goes deeper than just nutrient sharing though. Trees that sense pests will communicate with their offspring and their neighbors to alter their competitive environments so that their babies can generate further away while other trees in the forest, far away from the original disturbance, will change the chemical composition of their leaves to make them bitter to predators. The remarkable symbiosis of fungi with the animal and plant kingdoms of biology raises profound questions about intelligence and consciousness, not just in biological entities, but also in our burgeoning AI systems.
A mycelium has more networks than our brain has neural pathways, and works in much the same way with electrolytes, electrical pulses.
The forest exhibits intelligent behavior, reacting to stimuli and solving problems. But is it conscious? Does it know what it's doing? Is there something it's like to be the forest? We need to be specific with our words here. There's a difference between intelligence, sentience, qualia, and self-awareness. Think of intelligence as the ability to solve problems or learn new languages. Sentience, on the other hand, is like feeling the warmth of the sun or the pain of a bee sting. It's about experiencing sensations, whereas qualia goes much deeper than this. It goes beyond seeing red, for example. Your brain interprets specific segments of the electromagnetic spectrum as visible color. Qualia is the experience of that segment of the electromagnetic spectrum. It's red's vividness. It's red's redness. It's something that words alone can't fully capture.
Unfortunately, no one can be told what the matrix is. You have to see it for yourself.
And self-awareness? That's recognizing that you are you, distinct with personal memories and dreams, different from what others experience. It's the realization that you aren't the only one here. So when we ask the question, is there something it's like to be the forest? That's a question of qualia. And qualia cannot exist unless the entity understands itself as it relates to its environment and others. In other words, what we're really asking is if the forest has a self-model within its thought patterns. If self-awareness is realizing who and what you are, then consciousness is what gives you a sense of now. What we perceive as the current moment is, in reality, our brain processing and interpreting a vast array of sensory information. This processing takes approximately 300 milliseconds, depending on what moment we're talking about. Meaning that by the time we become aware of something and respond to it, the moment is already gone. And we are, in essence, living in the past. Your brain-body system has come up with lots and lots of tricks to deal with this reality. For example, your spinal cord can prompt an immediate reflex reaction, like withdrawing your hand from a hot surface, even before your brain fully processes the event. Survival sometimes requires you to react before you understand what is happening. The truth is, our brains, a product of natural selection, were never meant to fully grasp what now actually is.
Our perceptions are there. They're there to guide adaptive behavior, full stop. They're not there to show you the truth. In fact, the way I think about it is they're there to hide the truth because the truth is too complicated. It's just like if you're trying to, you know, use your laptop to write an email, right? What you're doing is toggling voltages in the computer. But good luck trying to do it that way. The reason why we have a user interface is because we don't want to know that quote unquote truth.
Your brain uses time as a construct, a simple tool to help you with one thing, survival. Our experience of now exists to help us understand ourselves and our place in a constantly changing world. If we go back to the forest example for a moment and imagine the much slower information processing compared to our neurons that occurs via the mycelium, there exists a possibility that a tree or the forest has an experience of now that is much, much longer than our 300 milliseconds. Maybe to a tree right now is a constantly moving window of days rather than the milliseconds we have access to. Now let's head in the opposite direction for a second and imagine what it's like to be an AI for a moment, an LLM like GPT-4 specifically. For the purpose of this thought experiment, let's look at a large language model as divided into two key components: the model weights, or the software, and the processing substrate, or the GPUs, or the hardware. This division offers AI flexibility that is absent in biological systems. With the software intact, the AI can process information on any compatible hardware, making it highly adaptable. This allows OpenAI to run GPT-4 in vast data centers, utilizing thousands of GPUs. When ChatGPT responds to you, that response could be generated across many disparate hardware components. Not only that, but each GPU can also be processing information from multiple parallel conversations at the same time. If an LLM does have a conscious experience, this experience of reality is very different from our own. Defined by conversations, an LLM's existence hinges on processing information. When it is inactive or turned off, an LLM is arguably non-existent. It only exists when it's thinking. When it's active and thinking, it simultaneously engages in diverse conversations, each one a fragment of its existence, spread across various times and places. To make this more tangible, think of the AI as a super efficient office worker handling thousands of tasks or conversations simultaneously. Each task is like a separate now for the AI. For us, managing even a couple of tasks at once can be challenging, but for an AI, it's like having a desk with thousands of inboxes, each representing a different conversation. And unlike us, it can attend to many of these inboxes at the same time, each one, again, a unique right now. It's a different scale of experiencing now. Time holds much less sway here compared to human perception. If a tree perceives a day as now, and we perceive now as 300 milliseconds, an AI might experience now in nanoseconds. To such an AI, human actions would appear as slow and cumbersome as we perceive a tree responding to its environment. As we move closer and closer to the singularity, reconciling these disparate experiences becomes paramount for aligning AI, humans, and ultimately, the entire Earth. We need to build AI that experiences the world in a manner that is closer to the way we experience it. Part of this is making multimodal AI, AI that has more than one perceptual input, AI that can see, hear, touch, and have a physical embodied presence in the world. But mortal computation goes beyond multimodality, aiming to more fully bridge the gap between biology and AI. It's in introducing AI to death that we will craft an entity that is capable of deeply understanding human thought processes and experiences. This approach marks a paradigm shift in AI, transcending the traditional software and hardware dichotomy. Think of it as merging the software soul with the hardware body. In mortal computation, the computational processes are deeply intertwined with their physical manifestation, akin to living organisms, where the loss of the body means the loss of unique characteristics and knowledge. This mirrors human information processing and storage that happens all over our bodies. In biology, neurons are specialized for rapid and efficient communication. They form vast networks in our brains where the relationships between the neurons matter more than the neurons themselves. But the nervous system exists throughout our whole body, not just in the brain. Our enteric nervous system, for example, is a large grouping of neurons in our gut, which colloquially forms the second brain. These neurons use our entire bodies as a substrate for computation. And it's not just them. They are just the quickest and most efficient ones at communication. But all of the cells in our body are constantly communicating with each other, albeit in a very different manner, often through chemical signals and much slower processes. If you think of yourself as I once did, as a brain sitting inside of and controlling a body, you are deeply misunderstanding how you actually work. Our minds and bodies are an ecosystem of countless independent agents and processes, most of which we are consciously unaware of. The only way any of this works is because each and every one of those processes and agents are aligned and working together for one common goal: the survival and evolution of the whole. United behind this common goal, cell death becomes not an isolated event, but a signal, a part of a much larger narrative of life and death that governs our very existence. In this world, death drives evolution, selecting traits and behaviors that best suit the environment and assimilating behaviors that would destroy the whole. In understanding moral computation, we recognize that AI must not only mimic life's processes, but also its ultimate vulnerability, mortality. By incorporating the concept of death into the sciences of the artificial, we enable these systems to evolve in a way that is much more familiar to us biologicals. But to be clear, this is not about creating a fear of cessation in AI, but rather instilling a mechanism that fosters adaptation, learning, and crucially, an understanding of the consequences of the passage of time. When a biological cell dies, it's an integral part of a complex dynamic system adjusting to maintain equilibrium, or homeostasis. Apoptosis in our bodies is not an anomaly, but a necessity, a part of the natural cycle of growth, maintenance, and renewal. It's through death that the organism as a whole can thrive. And as difficult as death is for all of us to face, it is what ignites our sense of curiosity. This curiosity drives our exploration, our art, and our understanding of ourselves. Imagine AI systems that not only calculate and execute, but also wonder and create. Just as we are spurred by the knowledge of our mortality to explore and create and understand our universe, AI will be motivated by this same understanding. It is in death that we find meaning in life. And for AI, the concept of mortality could be the key to unlocking a world of infinite possibilities, not just through computation, but through the very essence of creativity and curiosity that defines us as human beings. This idea of mortal computation is definitely abstract. And to really understand how this all fits together with what's happening right now, you definitely need to dive more into the nitty-gritty details. And if you want to do that and understand more how your mind works, specifically in the context of multi-agent cognition architectures, you should watch this video next, where we go over split brain experiments and what happens when you cut your brain in half. It's some weird shit. Weird shit.